one of the things that we're hoping as we walk down our pathway for success is that we can take advantage of the funding that NIAMS has already provided to us. For example, one of the points that we're going to stress later in our presentation this morning is that it's allowed us to look at the natural history, some of the clinical changes in patients with this most common form of muscular dystrophy, myotonic dystrophy, that would help us determine the most sensitive endpoints to use in a treatment trial. And NIAMS has also supported pathophysiology or pathomechanism studies performed by Charles Thornton in our laboratory and co-workers with him, Thurman Wheeler, in which there's been an important breakthrough discovering that the gene defect in myotonic dystrophy and the symptoms is created by toxic RNA. And as you can see from this schematic from the article in Science, that these big hairpin loops of RNA bind a nuclear regulatory factor that I'll talk about later on that is called muscle blind, that's very important in regulating splicing and ordering of the blueprint of messenger RNAs for a host of RNAs. And we've been able to capitalize on the monies that NIH has provided to develop a new antisense therapy that I'll mention briefly in just a moment. Now, there are a number of opportunities that NIH continues to facilitate that are listed on this slide. Obviously, the biggest advantage any investigator doing clinical studies has is the group of patients and family members that are willing to come and help them. And our NIH funding has made that possible, not just because we have these grants, but specifically because NIAMS funded the National Registry of Myotonic Dystrophy and FSH patients and family members. And after 12 years of funding, we have a large cadre of patients and families who are committed. And then as a part of this funding, we've been able to create advocacy groups. Fortunately, the first Wellstone Center was generously supported by the MDA. And we could see all of these things working to our advantage. Now, my purpose in talking to you this morning is not just simply to say, well, gee, in Rochester, we've had all these things happen, and it's really wonderful. And we feel that way. We feel very fortunate. But I was hoping to describe the approach and the components in the approach that we're using to try to discover and implement new treatments for muscular dystrophy. I'm hoping that some of this carries over to the diseases that are top priority for you, so that in the panel discussion, our conversation will include areas of common interest, not just, oh, gee, that gentleman talked about a rare neuromuscular disease. But let me turn to neuromuscular diseases and point out that NIAMS mission includes a large number of muscle disorders into which research is being sought to figure out the causes, treatment, and prevention. And as you heard from Dr. Collins and from Dr. Katz, there have been tremendous breakthroughs in discovering the molecular pathology, particularly for the muscular dystrophies. And it's a time of great opportunity as well as challenge. Now, I'm just going to talk about myotonic dystrophy, not only because of time, but because of some of the breakthroughs that we think we're poised to pursue. So what is myotonic dystrophy, Steinert's disease, or myotonic dystrophy type 1? It's an autosomal dominant disease. It's the most common form of muscular dystrophy in adults. It causes distal weakness. It's highly variable, as you can see from this father and son. The degree of weakness and wasting in both the face and the forearm differs. And then these patients have myotonia, as probably some of you have seen. If the patient squeezes their hand, they can't peel out their fingers. Their voice will intermittently get slurred until they warm it up. They have trouble swallowing. Their gastrointestinal function is altered. Women have trouble with pregnancies. And then it's a multi-system disease and involves a lot of other organ systems. And you might think, well, if you really discover a treatment that's effective for this rare disease, maybe it will have some spin-off and help much more common illnesses and help us understand more effective therapy for that. Now, back in 1992, when the gene was discovered and the unstable CTG repeat expansion was identified as the culprit, a diagnostic test was developed, and it showed that the size of that CTG repeat could predict the fact that the mother is really minimally affected, while her two affected daughters show more severe disease, just like in the father, and that actually more severe disease occurred with increasing size of the CTG repeat. Now, normally that repeat should be somewhere between 5 and 30 repeats, but as you can see from looking both at the grandfather, who has only a few repeats, and then looking at the daughter, the mother of the little baby with severe congenital myotonic dystrophy, the number of repeats is increasing. Now, the mother's brother, we don't have the number of repeats, but it's greater than hers. So you see a family that when the congenital myotonic dystrophy baby was initially diagnosed, suddenly people who didn't even know they had a disease and people who thought they had minimal symptoms, they're devastated by the information, gee, what is it that we have to deal with? Well, they're dealing with a gene, this dystrophica myotonia protein kinase gene, the myotonic dystrophy gene, in which, in contrast to most genetic diseases, the exons and introns are all normal. There's not a mutation there. The problem is in this non-coding region where the CTG repeats get bigger and bigger, as you can see from the results on this slide. And the culprit is actually not the DNA. It's the RNA copied from this DNA, and it's that RNA that tends to form this huge, long CUG repeat expansion that globs up in the nucleus. And when that occurs, you have a lot of derangement in the function of nuclear regulatory proteins, as I've tried to outline in this somewhat busy slide. Now, if you can imagine that there are specific regulatory proteins that are assigned to take different messenger RNAs, pre-mRNA that needs to be edited, and that they are like foremen on the job, and they're trying to decide the proper way to prepare RNA so that that RNA leads to the production of the desired protein. Let's say like the chloride channel. If you don't have a normal chloride channel, you have myotonia. Or for example, like the insulin receptor. You'll have insulin resistance if you make the fetal isoform of the insulin receptor. Those are two examples of what happens in the pathomechanism of myotonic dystrophy. So if you read with me, these RNA regulatory proteins, that is muscle blind, act like foremen on the job, and they're normally sort of freely moving around. They can attach to the messenger RNA that they're supposed to, direct it properly, and you can see that that is that nuclear regulatory protein, muscle blind in this case, is distributed throughout the nucleus. But what happens in the patients with myotonic dystrophy? Looks like it's all glopped up in this one little area. In fact, all the regulatory proteins are bound to these long CUG repeats. That's not good. They're stuck. They're not doing their job. So you're in default mode. So you don't make the right form of the insulin receptor. You don't make adequate chloride channel. And there are a whole host, over 100 proteins, that are out of kilter because the RNA is not being read properly. So what to do? Well, there are some experimental therapies that we could consider. They're listed on this slide. And what we decided to do was to pursue two of them. We thought it was a good plan to figure out some way to free up the nuclear regulatory protein so it could do its job from that big hairpin loop of RNA, and that it would be nice to just get rid of the toxic RNA. So Thurman Wheeler in our lab, working with colleagues in private industry, particularly at ISIS, developed an antisense oligonucleotide and used it in an animal mouse model of myotonic dystrophy that we had developed. And after a single injection of this antisense molecule, and the details are described in this article in Science, you can see the contrast. If you compare this tibialis anterior muscle from a mouse that received only the placebo to the animal that received the active treatment with antisense, you can see in the mouse that had the placebo injection, that mouse muscle has myotonia, it has abnormal muscle cell structure, just like you'd expect in a patient with myotonic dystrophy, and has all these little clumps of nuclear regulatory protein attached to RNA. It's cleared out in the mouse that received the antisense. Pretty promising result. So how do we apply these exciting findings to discovery of new treatments for patients? We currently are trying to accelerate and intensify our search for new antisense molecules using the mouse model. And I will share with you briefly that we've now got a new treatment that we inject subcutaneously, and for at least a few months after a single injection, it appears to have cured the mouse. Now, the mouse is not a person, and we need to start preparing ourselves to study patients. And there's an urgent need because we're hopeful that some of these antisense molecules will pass muster for FDA in the very near future. And so fortunately, again, we're receiving support from NIH, and we're receiving support to proceed with studies in patients. As I said before, we've developed partnerships with patients because of, again, funding through NIH. And we wanted to pursue studies both of what are the proper endpoints that are meaningful to patients to measure all the different disease manifestations in myotonic dystrophy, and are there any biomarkers? Is there anything that we could measure that would be a surrogate to indicate we could follow it and anticipate that a therapy is really working? And so this busy slide is an example of a type of disease progression natural history study that's part of our Wellstone Center grant. And what's happened is we've partnered with 80 patients with myotonic dystrophy type 1, and they are all coming in for baseline follow-up exams at 12 and 36 months and undergoing a number of tests to help us identify the most useful and valid endpoints to use to monitor for future therapy. And we're also talking to patients and trying to find out what they think is the most important endpoint for us to follow. And then we're using very, very small needles to obtain sort of micro biopsies of the muscle that's down on your shin bone, you know, the one that tips up your ankle, the tibialis anterior. And then we're doing molecular studies to look for some of the splicing abnormalities, the abnormalities in the way RNA functions and the way that it binds to muscle blind and the way it splices. And that's shown in the right-hand panel. Actually, this represents a population of the first 50 patients that have participated in this study, and we've obtained these very small microscopic biopsies, and we've measured the amount of inclusion of exon 7, which is one of the exons that's very involved in the chloride channel. And normally, it should be fully included. And as you can see, there are a few patients that are similar to the normals, but that as patients get weaker, you can see roughly a linear decline in this particular alteration in the splicing of the chloride channel. Myotonia, chloride channel, all of these things are inherently present in the vast majority of patients with myotonic dystrophy. We're very excited. Maybe this is really a biomarker that we can use. So we're ready to move forward with therapy. But you're saying, well, wait a minute. There probably are challenges ahead. So let me just close with two slides to agree with you and simply say, just like I'm sure all of you are thinking out there in the audience, you know, I'm hearing this guy talk about treatment, and he sounds really excited, but how are you going to deal with all these patients? And what are their expectations? You know, they're going to be the people who lined up for the study. Are they going to get the drug? But what about the people who were worse off and didn't make the inclusion criteria? What about people who are carrying the gene, don't have symptoms? What about little children? Do we have any knowledge of the natural history? How about encouraging new partnerships, and how do we work to make the treatments more economical and available to everybody? And what are the best steps to form the teams that I sort of alluded to that need to be formed to bring new treatments from the laboratory to patients? And what would you say are the most effective approaches to enhance funding of high-quality research? We certainly heard something from our earlier speakers this morning to give us advice. And how do we translate findings in a rare disease like myotonic dystrophy to other muscle disorders? Those are some of the questions that I thought you might want to discuss in the panel discussion that's coming up. And I welcome that opportunity. And again, I appreciate the chance to share this information briefly with you. Thank you very much.